Welcome to 20th lecture of AICD. In today's class, we'll quickly see how we can use an active load, especially an asymmetric load, for a differential amplifier. So in the discussions we made in the class, we took a resistive load as an example, and we understood the large signal characteristics. We looked at common mode response. We also saw small signal analysis, and from the small signal analysis, what we have done on the other day, that is the when you have a symmetric circuit with anti-symmetric excitation, we have looked at the line of symmetry by considering that at zero. We solved and we got the half circuit and we obtained the voltage gain. Similar way, those resistors can be replaced using load. Either it can be diode connected load or it can be current source load or of any type. Now in today's class, we will look at a specific way of replacing the resistors with an active load, or this can also be considered as an extension of using current mirror as a load for a differential amplifier. All right, so the topic today what we'll be discussing will be differential amplifier using active load. Differential amplifier using active load. So as I mentioned just now, this can also be thought as a differential amplifier having a current mirror as load. So the very first question is, why we need an active element? Why we need an active element as load? Why can't we continue with the resistive load? We have answered this question even before, but we'll be reiterating the same thing here. Element as load. Can I get your answers or your thoughts on this? Why we need an active element as load? So when I say active element, generally we prefer MOSFETs as load instead of keeping resistors as load. What is the reason for that? Can I get your answers in the chat box?
So is it maybe due to? Excuse me, sir.
I'm not able to. Yeah, I think your voice is breaking. You can give your response in the chat box.
Okay.
Size constraints is what Akash. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe you're telling resistors would be bulky for a larger value. Yes, that will consume larger power. Yeah, that is one reason. Any other? So control, yeah, something related to power. Yes, power consumption is more, or the power loss. Yes. Yeah, so the resistors are only of standard value. Yes, standard value resistors are available. Yeah, but in the case of integrated circuit, even we can go for specific resistance values. But that, even then, the thoughts or the points like the size of the resistor, the dissipation in the resistor, all those things matters. Yeah. So if you specifically say the reason, we have discussed this once. See, now in the load, in the place of this load, you can see that there is a resistor. Right. So if we replace this using an active load, the meaning is this resistor will be replaced with a suitable load, and that suitable load in this case should be a current, should be a PMOS load, PMOS active load. So there are various reasons why we prefer MOSFET load instead of a resistive load. The very first reason is the impedance resistance seen from this side of MOSFET is basically R naught. The resistance seen is R naught. So I can say this PMOS should be in saturation. This PMOS should be in saturation, and in saturation, we will get very high incremental resistance. It is not a physical resistance present there, but this is an incremental resistance. So how does it matter how this helps? Incremental resistance helps because we work with small signals. So for a small change, when there is a change in input signal, we are also getting an incremental resistance for that. Now, what about the drop across the MOSFET? So drop across the MOSFET, as we discussed before, drop across the MOSFET is as low as 0.5 VOV. VOV is the overdrive voltage of the MOSFET. Basically, what we call it VGS minus VT is the overdrive voltage. And one more very important thing is the drop across MOSFET does not depend on R naught, right? So even though MOSFET is providing an incremental resistance of R naught, the drop across the MOSFET is not depending on that value. Why do I say that? Say this is resistance R, and the resistance seen from the drain is R naught. But if you look at the drop across this resistor, that is directly proportional to the resistance value, or it will be equal to the current into resistance. But that is not true in the case of a MOSFET, because since R naught is not a physical resistance, even though a current flow through that MOSFET, the drop across MOSFET is as low as the overdrive voltage. So that is a very basic advantage why we are moving into, or why we replace the resistive load using a MOSFET load, right? So whenever we use MOSFETs in whichever configuration, it can be diode connector, it can be any form, whenever we use MOSFET in place of resistors, we call that the differential amplifier is having an active load. Right. So what I will do now is I will see how I can replace this resistor using a MOSFET and how I can alter the entire structure. Right. So for that, what I will do now is So I just replace the same circuit here. So my concern, or what I am going to do here, is I want to replace this resistor using a suitable load. And I know that when a load should be connected to the power supply, that should be a PMOS load. So I am connecting a PMOS load here in this fashion. All right. So this is my output point anyway. Now this is VDD. Now this is R. Let R be there for the time being. Now I kept a MOSFET here. Now I am little. I'm trying to see how I can properly bias this MOSFET. So let this is M1 and M2. I'll number these transistors little late. Now we know that generally if I want to bias this MOSFET, generally I mark a voltage VB here. But in integrated circuits, I think I mentioned this before once. We will use current mirrors for biasing, right? In order, if I want to bias a circuit, we generally prefer current mirror biasing, or constant current biasing is what is generally preferred in an IC. All right. So I can give a little more explanation for that. So when I say the voltage here is VB1 or whatever voltage it is, when I write that, the point is here I need to connect a VDD. VDD can be of some voltage. Say VDD is of 3 volt. Now here I am writing it as VB1, and say I need some 1.5 voltage here to maintain the saturation condition of that MOSFET. So does it mean that I will use different supply voltages on the same IC? So I should have a supply voltage of 3, then I should have a supply voltage of 1.5. Now if there are many more transistors, each transistor need to be biased suitably with a particular gate voltage, and we will not have the, or we cannot have all such supply voltages together on an IC. What we can have is only a single supply voltage, so that we have to decide the largest voltage required. Based on that, we will choose a supply voltage. And from that supply voltage, you are supposed to generate all the voltages what you need. So when you say generate, you should use certain circuits to generate the required voltage for your devices in the circuit. Are you guys with me? Can I get your response? Are you guys with me? listening, and are you guys able to understand what I'm trying to say here? I'll repeat what I'm saying is on an IC, we cannot have multiple supply lines coming in. That is not the standard way of doing it. So we will have a single supply line, and whatever voltage we need, we will generate from that supply line. Now, it's a very common approach is if you have a supply line, we can actually generate the required voltage by dropping two resistors and getting a suitable voltage here. And this can be designed by suitably choosing R1 and R2. But for the reasons mentioned before, we will not prefer this kind of biasing. This biasing is known as voltage divider biasing. We will not prefer this kind of biasing. Then what do we do here? So in such cases, especially in integrated circuit, we go for something called as current biasing or constant current biasing. And that is done with the help of circuits called as current mirrors. And current mirrors are something what you are familiar from your AMC classes. So how will I connect a current mirror here? So I need to provide a suitable voltage here to the gate of this transistor. So what I will do is I'll just extend this to this point. I'll draw it neatly anyway. So what I'll do is I'll just extend this, and I know that for a current mirror, I need to connect another transistor here. And that should be a diode connected structure, and that should be suitably pumped using a current source. Can you visualize the diagram which is written with navy blue color? I should have used a different color. So with the navy blue color as a current mirror, usually for a NMOS current mirror, you will draw in this fashion, right? Your gate and drain will be shorted, and that will be connected to the gate of the other transistor. So what is the meaning here? Depending on this current, this transistor will generate a VGS voltage, and that VGS voltage is available for the second transistor, and that transistor is biased properly. That is the meaning here, right? In a similar way, so I need to choose a suitable current value here. Based on that, a VGS voltage will be available here with this transistor, and that value will be, one second, So this is the, I have to choose a specific current. That current, based on that current, you will have a specific VGS, and that VGS will be available to the other transistor, and that is biased. This is the way generally we do. All right. Now, my very first question is, what should be this current value? In order to bias this device, what should be this current value? Now, say that this current value is I0. DC current, I'm talking about the DC current, because VGS voltage is generated by the help of a DC current. Can I get your response in the chat box? If you have I0 current here, what current I should provide here in order to bias the voltage? So just I'm numbering this as M3 and M4. So in order to bias M4, what current I should choose? Yes, it is I0 by 2. Why it is I0 by 2? We know that this branch and this branch both will carry I0 by 2. So the current carried by M4 is I0 by 2. So for a suitable voltage to be generated, I have to provide a current of I0 by 2 here. I hope this is clear. Now, looking at the circuit, you can clearly see that the resistor which is here, the resistor which is available in the circuit is of no use in this specific case. Why I would say that? Because you can see that M4 is suitably biased here, and you will get an output here, but the resistor is consuming an extra current here, and that is actually giving you an additional power consumption of, say, that current into resistance, right? Now, I can say this only if I am not interested in a differential output, because whenever we talk about a differential amplifier, we are looking for a differential input and differential output. But if I need a circuit which can convert a differential input into single ended, or if I am interested only in one output from here, I can definitely say that the resistance or this branch is definitely creating some kind of loss, because if I'm not interested to take the signal from this point, from the drain of M1, definitely R is giving you some loss. So the idea here is, look at the circuit. M1 has to have, M1 will be carrying a current of I0 by 2. Now M3 also need a current source which has to be I0 by 2 to provide, to generate suitable voltage. So the easiest way or the best way is actually to remove the resistance from the circuit and connect the load in such a way that so in place of using an additional current source there, that can be directly connected to M1 transistor and on this side to the M2 transistor, and with the tail current source here with I0 value. So this will be anyway carrying current of I0 value. So M1 will be providing the current which is required for this transistor to bias, and that can be directly connected to this device. So as a result, this is your M1 device, this is your M2 device, this is M3, this is M4, and from you here you can take the output as V out, and this is where you are actually providing you the differential input. You can mark it as V in 1 or V in 2, or together you can mark it as VID. Right. Now you'll be wondering what I have done here. So this circuit is called as differential amplifier using active load, or a differential amplifier using active current mirror, or this is otherwise used to, this is actually differential to single-ended conversion circuit. I'll explain the need of this. So we discussed about the advantages of differential amplifier, but in most of the cases, or in specific cases, we know that always at the end of any system, we may need to drop, say for example, for a public address system, we may need to drive a loudspeaker. Loudspeaker is basically, it is an impedance, or it is a resistance provided at the one end. So in many such cases, or in order to drive a load, we need a single-ended output, or we say for example, if I need to drive this load, I need to connect only one point here, or I need a single-ended output. So in such cases, or whenever there is a need of single-ended, but when we have differential output available, and if I need to drive a load that need only single-ended voltage, we will use this circuit in between, where the circuit can accept differential input, and it can provide single-ended output. Is this clear what I'm telling? So what I did is, I just replaced the resistor there, and I connected the drain, the gate and drain shorted point of M3 device to the drain of M1 itself, so that the DC current I0 by 2 is available there, and M3 will suitably bias M4. The only difference from the previous or the other circuits what we discussed is, if you look at the load, if you look at this top part, you can see that this is in fact a current mirror. Right, this is in fact a current mirror. So that is the reason why we call the circuit as differential pair with an active load, or with a current mirror load, or with an asymmetric load, because you know, the circuit is not symmetric, because one side you have a diode connected structure and other side you have a current source. M4 is acting as a current source, but M3 is basically a diode connected structure. So the circuit is not symmetric, because if you draw a line of symmetry on both sides, you can definitely see there is a difference because of the connection available. All right, are there any questions on this? So the need of the circuit is, whenever you have a differential voltage and when you and the requirement is a single ended, this circuit can convert that differential voltage into single ended. Any questions? Why don't we use diode connected load for M4? M4. So Anushka, I think I was explaining from that side. I want to replace resistor using a suitable MOSFET load, right? So if I'm trying to use a diode connected structure, tell me what is a incremental resistance available for me. The incremental resistance available is 1 by GM parallel to R4, which is actually a low value. So as we are taking output from this point, I'm drawing output from here, V out, and that node, your gain depends on the output impedance of that node, right? Since the drains are tied together, you are actually getting a larger output impedance there. But if you say your M4 is diode connected, definitely your gain or your output impedance will be very, very small. It will be 1 by GM parallel to R0, which is smaller value compared to R0. All right, yeah, that is a good question. Okay, now if you understood this, now the task is how to find the differential gain of the circuit, because the method what we have taken before was specifically for a circuit which is symmetric, but the excitation is anti-symmetric. Yeah, Shriharsha, your question is it fine if you lose symmetry? Yeah, so circuit wise we lost symmetry. Circuit wise we lost symmetry, that is true. So that is okay, for the reason that we are not expecting a differential output here, rather we are expecting only a single ended output. For that reason, losing symmetry in the circuit is fine, right? But altogether, the application of this circuit is slightly different. As I was explaining, the circuit is used whenever you need to convert a differential signal into a single ended one, we use the circuit. Is it clear, Shriharsha? Yeah. Okay, so now the task here is we need to find the differential gain of the circuit. So we need to find what is the differential gain of the circuit. Differential gain. But the method what we have studied just now, that is, we cannot consider the circuit as symmetric, even though the excitation is anti-symmetric, and we cannot extend the method what we use there now to this point, right? So what I do is, but definitely I can say, let me just take the same circuit to the next page. All right, so what we will do now is we need to find the differential gain, right? So how will I find differential gain? In general, we have taken AB can be the magnitude of gain, can be always written as GM into R0. This is the method what we used for all the common source applications, common source amplifier. I'm trying to extend the same thing over here. So how is I'll find GM separately and R0 separately, right? That is the approach what I'm going to do now. Now, how will I find GM? So GM is a short circuit transconductance. So to find GM, what should I do to find GM? I know that if I want to find GM, I need to short the output node, short the output terminal to ground. So I will do such changes with a different color. So I'm just shorting this output node to ground. Then what is the second step? Second step is I need to mark a short circuit current. So that will definitely have a short circuit current. And I, in this case, I'll take the short circuit current as I out. Say I'm marking this current as I out. Now, after that, what I should do? I should measure what is I out by VID, and that will give you the short circuit transconductance capital G. This is what the method what we used in order to find what is capital G. Now I'll do the same thing over here. So I am just connecting. Okay, now I shorted this output to ground and I marked I out. Now I need to find what is I out by VID. Before that, if you are providing VID here, what is the meaning? VID by 2 on this side. This is VID by 2 and this is minus VID by 2. That is how you can say that there is a differential voltage of VID applied across. Now, if VID by 2 is on this side, what will be the current flowing here? The small signal current will be always GM into VGS. Now, in this case, it is GM into VID by 2. Similarly, on the other side, this current will be equal to minus GM into VID by 2. Is this clear? I'm just marking the small signal current in the circuit. So since the differential voltage is VID, and on one side it is VID by 2, on the other side is minus VID by 2. So I can mark the small signal currents as GM VID by 2 and minus GM VID by 2. Is this clear? Can I get some response? Can I get some response as yes or no? Or if you have question, please raise a question now. All right. Now, so I know the current flowing through M1 and M2. So if M1 is carrying the current of GM VID by 2, the same current, because there is no other way for M3 to carry some different current. So the current through M3 is also GM VID by 2. Now we can see that M3 and M4 form a current mirror. So if M3 is M3 and M4 form a current mirror, whatever current M3 is carrying, the same current only M4 can carry, that is GM VID by 2. Right. So see my approach, what I have done is I shorted the output node to ground. I marked what is I out there. Then based on the differential input voltage, I marked the current flowing through M1 and M2. But all these are small signal analysis. But because why, what I'm going to find is small signal voltage gain. So I got this current, I got the current through M2. Now looking at M3, M3 is getting the same current as M1. So the same current is GM VID by 2. And now the same current is mirrored to M4. So that current is also GM VID by 2. Now what I need to find is, I need to find what is I out. So what is I out? So now I am at this point where I have three currents coming in. Incoming current is GM VID by 2. This current I need to find what it is. And this current is minus GM VID by 2. Now in this case, can you tell me what is I out? What is I out current? So from GM VID by 2, current is coming here. But from here, the outgoing current is some value. And the current flowing down is minus GM VID by 2. So in this case, what is I out? You can just apply KCL. Yes, it is equal to GM VID, because how can you say that incoming current is only 1, which is GM VID by 2. In sum of incoming current is equal to sum of leaving currents. Leaving current is I out minus GM VID by 2. So if you perform this, you will get that I out is equal to GM VID. So if I out is GM VID, I can directly write what is I out by VID, that is equal to GM. GM means GM of what? GM of input device. It can be both GM1 or 2. So I'll write GM1 or 2. This is the short circuit transconductance capital GM. If you remember, I told you that when we go for circuits with larger number of transistors, the analysis, we will not perform the analysis by replacing the equivalent circuit of MOSFET. Rather, we will take a shortcut approach of this fashion. Yes, Avinash, you are right. So while calculating GM, we have to remove a load. If there is a load directly, you can, so in this case, you cannot remove the load as such, because you have an active load considering on both branches. So if you have a resistive load or if you have a single-ended circuit, you can directly remove that load and short it. All right. So if I remove the load portion of this, I will not be able to I will not be able to analyze the circuit itself. But that is not in for single-ended circuits. Whenever you have load, you are directly shorting it and you are marking that current as Iout. But that will not disturb the analysis of the remaining analysis. It will not get disturbed. But in this case, you cannot plug the load and take it away. If you do that, you will be lost, because the small signal current itself is flowing through the load. If you look at this side, the small signal current coming here is not only because of this current, the device M2, because of this current mirror circuit, some portion of current is flowing from the other branch also. So in that case, you cannot remove the load directly as how we have done in the case of a single stage amplifier. Is it clear? Nevertheless, by shorting the output node to ground, the effect remains as same. So if you remember what we were doing before is, we will remove the load and connect that point to ground. We retain the same thing. We connected the output point to ground, but retain the active load part, because the load is active and the current flowing through the output path depends on some other path. Or since you have a current mirror load, you may not be able to directly disconnect it. And this will be the approach what we'll be following for all the differential circuits. Yeah, so Srihash, if you're asking the question raised by Avinash, so what I'm telling is, for all the single-ended amplifier circuits, say for example, say this is the circuit you have, and you want to find Iout by Vin, or you want to find the circuit transconductance capital GM. In that case, what we did is, we were directly shorting this point to ground, right? So, but before that, we were telling you will remove the load device, and then you will short that node to ground, and then we will extract a current Iout, which is a small signal current, and based on this Iout and Vin, we'll find it. Now, if you look at the circuit, the small signal current flowing in the circuit is not. Neither way it is independent of the resistance which is connected over here, right? Because a small signal current is flowing here because of Vin, and that is having all the way, there is a path over here, right? And the current coming here or the current flowing here is not dependent on any other branch. I think you will agree to that. But now in your differential amplifier case, in this case, when I look at the small signal current flowing here on this, now, when I look at the small signal current at the output node, definitely the load is also playing a role in the small signal current flow, because the load here is basically a current mirror. So since it is a current mirror, the current from the other branch also need to be taken care. So if I directly remove the load and say I am shorting this output to ground, I will end up in writing that your Iout is just equal to GM by 2, right? But that is wrong in this case. Why it is wrong? Because we are totally neglecting the role of the current mirror in the small signal operation. Is that convincing, Avinash and Sriharsha? I didn't get Sriharsha. What is the question? Since already current exists, we need to take care. I didn't get Sriharsha. You can, if you want, you can unmute and just tell me what you're thinking.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, yes, Sriharsha. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. In the light blue case, like when we add resistor, since we connect VDD to the other end, which will ground when we take GM, so there is no current actually in general. Whereas in this case, because of current mirror,
no current.
Whereas in this case, since already we have current, we are considering it.
What current? There is a small signal current contribution from other branch.
Yes.
There is a small signal current contribution from the other branch. But here that is not the case.
Yes.
Yeah. Avinash, did you get clarity on what I said? All right, yes. So that is GM. Now the next task is how I can find R out. R out is the output impedance, right? So how will I find R out? So I'll quickly do that. So R out calculation. Yes.
So just a minute.
Could yes, Adil.
Could yes. you show that?
Which one? The previous one. Yeah, sure. Not this. Yeah.
So here, sir, at the node between M1 and M2, like if we apply KCL, it doesn't hold good if we take the current source also, right?
So Aditya, whenever I say this, this voltage gain, this is small signal voltage gain. And for the small signal voltage gain, what is the condition of this current source?
Oh, okay. It's open.
Yeah, it remains as open.
Yeah, sure. Got it. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. So coming to R out calculation. So what I will do for R out calculation is R out calculation remains the same. I'll just redraw the circuit here. Now I'm just omitting anyway that current that current will not be there. It will be open. Now I need to short the input. Okay, changes.
Sir, was that last circuit you discussed an OPAM?
Which one? This one. This one. Hello, I'm not able to hear you. Amo? Yeah, Amok, I didn't hear you. Yeah. Please.
When the last circuit you discussed an OPAM.
You're talking about this circuit?
Yeah, that the previous one was that an OPAM?
Is that
an OPAM circuit?
Is that an OPAM?
Yeah.
OPAM is what you're asking. OPAM.
OPAM, yes.
Yeah. So this is a differential amplifier. But nevertheless, we say this is the very the basic form of an op-amp. Yes, that is right. Even though we call this as a differential amplifier, this is a very basic form of an op-amp, operational amplifier. Yes. All right. So let me quickly. Any more questions on that? Okay, so let me find the output impedance now. So input should be grounded. I need to connect a source here. Let me mark this as Vtest. So this as Itest. Now this is M1, this is M2, this is M3, and this is M4. Right. So one thing you can directly say by just looking at the circuit, the output impedance, I am connecting the source here. So you can directly go for the impedance seen upwards and impedance seen downwards, and you can say the parallel combination of both those as the final output impedance. But as I mentioned, for the reason stated before, since you have an active load, a current mirror load, you have to see the effect of the current flowing from M3 to M4 also. That is why we are actually taking a mathematical approach to find the output resistance. All right. So in this case, when you provide an ITEST current here, you can say that, let me mark this current as, say, I1 and this as I2. Because ITEST current will definitely divide into two, one as I1 and another one as I2. So I will write here as, so my aim is to find what is Vtest by Itest, thereby I can find the output impedance of the circuit. So what is Itest here? Itest is I1 plus I2, right? Now, what is I2? How can I say, how will I define I2? I2 is basically the current which is flowing from this node to ground. So what is the voltage here? Voltage is Vtest divided by what is the resistance seen down. I'll just mark that resistance as say some R. What is the R value? I am looking at the drain of M2. So if this node was ground, if this node was ground, I can say the resistance seen from this point, the drain of M2 will be R0 of M2 device, right? But now this point is not ground. Rather, this node, I again seeing a resistance here, which is closely equal to 1 by GM1. In that case, can you guys tell me what is the impedance seen at the drain of M2? How will I write this resistance R? What is this R?
GM R not RS.
Yes, you directly said GM R not, that is right. Or if I write the exact value, it is R not 2 plus 1 by GM 1 plus GM 2 R not 2 into 1 by GM, right? The other one is also right. If you write GM 2 R not 2 1 by GM 1, that is also correct. Now, so anyway, I'm just doing some small modifications in this. GM1 and GM2 remain same because both transistors will be identical, the input transistors. In that case, this GM2 and the other GM2 will get cancelled. Right. So this GM2 and this will get cancelled because since GM1 is equal to GM2, so the resultant will be equal to, you can say that this is equal to 2R02 plus 1 by GM1. But 2R0 is a very large value. I'm adding a small resistance to that. So this can be approximated as 2R0 to itself. So whatever approximations I made, I am just telling the reason also for that. So that is towards I2, right? So I2 I obtained. So I need to find what is Vtest by Itest. So I now I know what is I2, right? So what is I2? I2 can be written as Vtest divided by 2R0 to. I hope that is clear. Similarly, how will I write I1? What is I1? I1 is actually the current flowing through M4. So how will I write I1? I1 is again, this node voltage is Vtest divided by the resistance seen up as M04 is R04. But you know that this I2 current is actually flowing here, right? That small signal current will actually take this path. That means N3 will carry this I2 current because I2 current is flowing here and it is going to the ground through this path through M1 and M2. So since this is carrying a current of I2, this current mirror will replicate that current here also. So I need to add I2 current also through this, or I should say I1 is equal to Vtest by R02 plus I2 because of the current mirror action. I hope that is clear. I2 current is flowing from M2 through M1 through M3 and it is flowing to ground. So the original current through M4 is actually I1, but through, due to current mirror action, I2 also will flow through M4. So I will say I1, the total current flowing through M4 is equal to Vtest by R04 plus this I2 current. Is that clear? Now, if that is the case, I'll just, if you have questions, I'll definitely take. So this is Vtest by R04. What is I2 current here? I2 current is Vtest by 2 times R02. All right. So that is I1. Now, what I need to find is not I1, it is Itest. So what is Itest? Itest is I1 plus I2. So what is I1? I1 is Vtest by R04 plus Vtest by 2R02, that is I1. What is I2? I2 is Vtest by 2R02. So I can say your total Itest is equal to Vtest by R04 plus Vtest by R02. Vtest by R04 plus, because there are two halves, so it is Vtest by R02. Or if I write Vtest by Itest in this case, this is equal to what you will get? You will get it as R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4. That is V test by I test, which is equal to R out. All right. So even though, so if you directly look at the node where you have connected V test, you can directly say that the two drains are tied together, and you can directly say that it is R naught 4 parallel to R naught 2. Nevertheless, I have done the detailed analysis and we have made some approximations here. That is why it is resulting in that value. Otherwise, you will get a slightly more value, but that is okay if you neglect that. Right. So your output impedance is R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4, and from the previous case, your GM is equal to GM 1 or 2. So by combining both, I can say voltage gain AV is equal to GM 1 or 2 into R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4. This is the differential. This is the differential gain. This is a voltage gain of a differential to single-ended amplifier circuit minus GM 1 2 in GM 1 2 into R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4. Yes, there are questions here. Isn't it inverse of that parallel combination? What is that, Anushka?
So I meant in the last step where you've written R naught 2 parallel R naught 4, shouldn't it be 1 by R naught 2 parallel R naught 4? Oh, it's I by V. Sorry, sir.
No. It's I by V, and I have written V by I. Yes, yes.
Okay, sir. Sorry.
Yeah. So yeah. For understanding purpose, I have done this derivation. But if you see the circuit, you can directly write what is AV. AV is GM minus GM into or GM into R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4. But you should also know how we have arrived at the expression by considering the small signal equivalent circuit. All right. So I hope this is clear. If you have questions, you can ask. So, okay. So I'm just giving you, so this is common mode gain. Sorry, this is differential gain AD. This is AV, or we call this as differential gain also, because the gain is for a differential input. Now I will write this as AD, which is GM 1 comma 2 into R naught 2 parallel to R naught 4. So similarly, you would have definitely heard about, so this is when you apply differential signal, and when you apply differential signal, the circuit will well respond to the differential signal, right? Circuit will definitely respond to a differential signal. But now, whenever you have common signals, your circuit, actually your common mode gain should be equal to zero. The circuit will never respond to common mode signal. When I say circuit will not respond to common mode signal, when you are giving a common signal, the expected output is actually zero, right? But that will not be always true. In practical cases, there can be some very small common mode gain. And if you analyze the common mode gain of the circuit, the gain will be equal to minus 1 by 2 GM3 RSS, where this RSS is the output resistance of the tail current source. I'm not doing this analysis now. Output resistance of the tail current source. All right, so this is common mode gain. And finally, if I write for the common mode rejection ratio, if you write for CMRR, common mode, what is CMRR? CMRR is basically AD divided by ACM, magnitude of AD divided by ACM. And if you derive the expression for that, it will be equal to, if I assume all like GM1 or this GM1 or 2 into the parallel combination, say I'm marking it as R naught into, sorry, R naught, if both are equal, it will be R naught by 2 into, sorry, divided by this quantity will come to the numerator. So 2 GM3 RSS, that will be equal to GM1 comma 2 into R naught into GM3 into RSS. So we are not deriving these things. So I'm just directly taken the equation for a common mode gain and then common mode rejection ratio. Right. So this is how you will get the common mode rejection ratio of the circuit. And common mode rejection ratio will be very, or larger the common mode rejection ratio, that is better for any differential amplifier. Because the main idea of a differential amplifier is to respond to a differential signal and give zero response to common mode signal, thereby giving a very large common mode rejection ratio. All right. So here we stop for today. Probably I can give one question as homework here. With that, we'll wind up and I'll tell you the rest of the plan for this week. So just note on this question, an active loader, most differential pair, say with a value of W by L of N MOSFET is 100, W by L of P MOSFET is 200. Given that mu n Cox equal to 2 times mu p Cox, which is equal to 200 microamps per volt square. The meaning is mu n Cox is 200 micro and mu p Cox is 100. Instead of giving lambda, they have given the early voltage VA of N and VA of P as 20, so which is basically 1 by lambda. Then tail current source ISS value is given as 0.8 milliamps with an RSS value, the resistance value there as 25 kilo. So the question is to calculate GM, Rout, AD, ACM and CMRR. All these things you have to find and calculate and see. So to just give clarity, if you look at the circuit diagram, that the tail you can actually add a current source, but now that current source has to have a practical output resistance of 25 kilo ohm. It is not, generally we leave with a current source value like this. Then what is the meaning of this? Output resistance is infinity, but now there is a practical value coming up which is equal to 25 kilo ohm, right? So this you can try, and so with this I am winding up for today, but please please wait. So we have to discuss certain things for we have to plan something for this week. Thank you so much for joining for today's class.